Tamsi Ringler, thank you very much for coming.
Oh, absolutely. Happy to be here, yeah. Thank you. I really became interested in art actually when I was in high school, and I went to art school in London for a year when I was in high school. And I just fell in love with art, with painting, with drawing, with sculpture. And that's really when it began. As a kid, I always loved drawing and painting, and my mom said I would just disappear for hours. You know, I would just get involved with it and be gone, you know. Mm-hmm. So,
was that part of a school program? Did a group of you go out, or did they just single you out because of some talent they saw?
My dad was working over there. Mm. And so instead of going to high school, it was an opportunity to go to an art school because they start much younger there. They start at like 16. Oh. So that, you know, I was there for a year, and then I came back and had to finish up American high school. That was hard.
Oh. After being good.
Yeah. But.
Mm. So, would you most of your current work is sculpture? Would that be fair to say?
Sculpture, yeah. Sculpture and installation and some performance art as well, but not performance in terms of often really me performing, but it's more me facilitating other people to interact in the sculptures I create or the spaces I create. So sometimes I'm there to invite people in to these spaces because they wouldn't come in if I wasn't there. So it does bridge kind of, you know, sculpture and all the way to performance.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah.
So you began drawing, and how and what was the evolution, I guess you would say, from moving from drawing to sculpture? How
did that? Yeah, I basically just took a sculpture class in college, and so I'd started out in drawing and painting, and I really wasn't expecting to fall in love with sculpture. But then I just love that ability to manipulate space and start to actually make what I'm thinking in my head real, as opposed to just flat, you know, making it something that people interact with and get involved with. So that's really where it started. And since then, I've, you know, they had brief forays into thinking I would do other things, but I've always come back to it, you know. I still draw, and I still do some painting, but primarily drawing.
Did you begin sculpting things you drew, or did you draw and sculpt things at the same time?
You know, it's funny. They're almost like separate processes. Like my drawing is much more expressive. I like to draw from the figure, the nude figure, and I like to use a lot of color, and it's very direct. And then I do some sketches for sculptures, but mostly it's a thought process I go through. There's a lot of actually almost engineering involved in terms of figuring out how I'm going to make this thing happen, because I kind of, a lot of my sculpture gets complicated physically, so there's a lot of that that goes into it. And I can't really draw what I'm seeing in my head.
Oh.
I can't, you know, like when I'm doing these sculptures with cars, I'm not very good at drawing cars. So I don't even try, you know. So I do some digital manipulation now of images for proposals of things. That helps me, so I don't have to draw cars and stuff.
Oh, good. Well, that segues nicely into the cast, the plaster cast we have here. What is this part of?
Well, this is a model for a larger sculpture I want to make, and this is actually a model that the final sculpture will be life scale. So my idea is, this is a proposal for Franconia Sculpture Park in Minnesota, which is a residential sculpture park where artists come and work for up 1 month, 3 months, and create large-scale sculpture. It's an outdoor studio, essentially. So my idea for this is that I will make a mold, a rubber mold, off of a real car. Mm-hmm. And then what I'll do is, usually when you make a rubber mold, because it's flexible, you know, it moves, you make what's called a mother mold that backs it up. It's like a rigid material that holds the rubber in so it doesn't distort.
Oh.
When you pour in,
oh, yeah,
whatever
of
material.
Course.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I'm going to do the opposite here. I'm actually going to make the rubber mold, but then not back it up. So when I pour in the concrete,
so it looks flattened out?
It'll
like
distort
that?
Like a puddle. So I don't know what it'll do. So this is just a model, you know, off of a, you know, a toy car. So.
And you poured it into a rubber mold without any that under support.
Exactly.
To get it to.
Oh, yeah. So I think in the actual final version, it'll be a lot more puddle-like. That's kind of my idea. So I like that idea of the distortion of the form. But then sometimes what I find is that after I start working on an idea, I'll realize that there are some other levels that it, you know, often there's a really, really subtle political overtone or undertone that sometimes I don't even realize until after I finish the piece. And I'm looking at it, I'm like, oh, okay, there is a little bit of that in there. So this is kind of an overhead view of it, as you can see. So you can kind of see. I mean, you know, after I actually take the mold off of the car and pour it in concrete, you know, usually cars, they aren't that tall. Surprising. You'd kind of think, given how tall we are, but cars are only 3 feet or so off the ground, if you really look at them, or maybe a little bit higher.
If you stand next to one for a while, you mostly stand over
above. Exactly, yeah. But once it's I've poured the concrete in and changed the mold, then the whole thing is going to basically squish down, okay? And so I'm not sure in the end what it's going to come out like. I'm not sure whether it's going to be, you know, how flat this kind of puddling effect will be. You know, I'll just have to wait and see what exactly happens as part of the process. And I enjoy that idea of not really knowing until, you know, it comes out of the mold.
Do you think there'll be a big, I guess because of size, there'll be a big transition from a small version to a big version? Will it do essentially the same thing?
That's a big issue.
That's a big if.
Yeah, that's a big if. I have to figure it out because, you know, it's what I need to look into more, and I was going to propose that this summer, but I'm actually going to propose it for a year from now because there's a lot of engineering involved. Like, what happens? How strong does the rubber have to be to take the weight of the concrete? And also, I don't want it to, you know, when you make a rubber mold, you get a kind of an uneven surface on the outside from applying the rubber.
Oh, mm-hmm.
And so if I just put it onto something flat, you know, like onto a floor, any surface kind of abnormalities on the outside will show up on the inside, you know, as the concrete presses down. So it'll look like a bumpy car, which I don't really want. So I want it to look more like a puddle. So then it raises the question of, am I going to have to like float it on something else? You know, like actually fill up a cavity with water and then pour concrete in so it's kind of suspended in the water.
Wow, I'm trying to picture that.
I know, I am too. Or maybe that won't work at all, this is the thing. So then I'm thinking maybe I have to like put on a really thin bed of concrete, you know, like a 3-inch bed of concrete that's
a bed of something smooth.
Put that in, and so when that's still wet, then put the concrete into the mold so it can find its own. Because concrete itself, once it's actually in a mold, it keeps its form. It'll respect the mold that was made, if that makes sense. But if it doesn't have anything to hold it up, it won't. So it's a big question.
All right. So we're standing here at a quickly thrown together mock-up of your living room display at Gresham Central Transit Center.
Yeah.
So using the mock-up, let's take me through exactly each piece.
This chair, this armchair, it was actually really a tricky sculpture to make because I cast it. It's the top part is in concrete, and the bottom of the chair is in bronze, cast bronze. And so this very heavy concrete casting has to be suspended on this bronze base, which holds it up above the mosaic floor. So it was very tricky to cast. My idea with all of the furniture was to have this kind of Americana look, circa, you know, your grandmother's house or something.
Mm-hmm.
So it actually took a long time to find the specific furniture that I was going to cast.
Yeah, what was it, antique store?
Antique stores, Goodwill, mostly, like the couch and the chair were antique stores. The TV was from Goodwill, and the coffee table, I think, was also Goodwill. So that was, but some of them took a long time. Like, couch took me a couple months to find the right couch.
Oh.
So that was kind of my creative part was shopping.
They do have that great Americana look, like with the fringe at the bottom. Yeah. I don't know how you we'll talk about that.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
The lamp.
Yeah, the lamp was completely fabricated. That mm-hmm. part was. It was like the top. It's just like a mesh, a steel mesh. I wanted, again, to look as, you know, just like an average American house, but again, a little bit nostalgic, all of this stuff. The base is cast iron, and that was cast off of a lamp I had, the actual base. And then some of the bronze fittings on it are actually, it's all kind of pieced together from different bits and pieces. So the bit, and that's actually where my name is on the sculpture, is on the base of the lamp and the date.
So, oh, I didn't yeah, check yeah, that out when
yeah,
I was looking.
Yeah, it's kind of hidden in
okay.
there. But,
oh, good. and moving on to the couch.
Yeah, well, the couch, that was the biggest issue of all. The mosaic, of course, was a big one, but we can talk about that. But the couch technically was very complicated. I mean, the chair was technically complicated, but the mold for the couch was very technically complicated. Because you're taking a big soft object and making a mold off of it that's big enough to hold basically like 3 tons of concrete. So it has to be very structural.
Wow.
And I had to make it as well so that if there was any problem, it could be recast. And there was a problem. So there was a lot of drama with the sculpture,
oh.
which you don't see. But the couch, the first time I cast it, I added pigment to it. So you see that's why it's pink. Mm-hmm. But I first added blue, and I added a little bit of white. And the pigment actually kind of wrapped around the bits of the cement. Mm-hmm. So it miscast. It actually made this like crumbly blue couch.
Oh.
So it was really lucky I'd put all the time into the mold, because the mold itself weighed about probably a ton and a half.
Was that's rubber?
Yeah, the rubber, and then over the rubber there was like a 16 part mother mold out of plaster that made it look like this huge, you know, huge thing, basically.
Oh, yes, the mother mold, the rubber sits in the mother mold to retain its shape.
Exactly. Mold's plaster, so that's rigid. And then outside of that was a wooden box, like a plywood box, to hold all the pieces of the mother mold together. And then outside of that was a steel frame to support the whole thing so it could be rolled over by a crane when it was cast. So it was a huge
rolled
project.
Rolled over by a crane? Oh.
Yeah, because I cast it upside down so that when the concrete truck came, they just poured the concrete into the open bottom of the couch.
Okay.
So then once it's upside down, it has to be rolled.
and how do you transport it? Flatbed?
Flatbed, yeah, flatbed and crane. So I hired a crane on site, mm-hmm. yeah, to move it. So, yeah, and that's all technically pretty complicated. And some of that was done on site, you know, like the molding, the pouring of the concrete was done on site. You know, the unmolding and molding of it, and then moving into place.
Okay, the table, that is cast in
bronze
as well?
Bronze, yeah.
Yes.
And that was another very complicated. I made all of the pieces off of a real wooden table. So everything here was what you see. So it was off of a wooden table, but big flat sections. And I did almost all of the work myself, all of the mold making. You know,
is that just so it would be exactly the way you wanted it?
Exactly the way I wanted it, and plus budget.
Oh,
yeah.
Right.
But also, I do enjoy the challenge. I do a lot of metal casting, and so mm-hmm. I enjoy the challenge of it. But big flat surfaces are some of the hardest things to cast in bronze,
yes.
or in any material without having them start to shift. And it was also pushing the limits of what I could do in the foundry I work in at Mountain Community College. And so I had to actually pour that tabletop 3 times before I got one that was acceptable.
Oh, it wasn't one piece.
It was one, well, the tabletop was one piece, and then the legs were separate pieces.
Oh, I see.
And then the side rails were separate pieces.
Oh.
So it was all assembled, because you can't just do big castings like that. You're risking too much, because the whole thing could, you know, not work, and then you'd have to do it again and again and again. And I, as it was, I had to do the top 3 times to get it. Yeah. So the TV, it's one of my favorite forms of all of the different forms here, just because of the, I like the integrity of it as an object, like the back of the TV.
Oh, yeah.
That's like my favorite part.
Yeah, me too, with the round part.
Yeah,
with the
I just want to touch it, you know. And then all the little holes. And that casting came out, you know, that like the vents on the back of the old console-style TV. And that was a funny TV. You know, I got that at Goodwill, the original. And it worked once on the Millennium, because there was an old tube TV in there. It worked once on the night of the Millennium. We got to see the fireworks, and then that was it.
Oh.
It never worked again. So, but the individual sections were all made off of the real pieces of wood and cast, you know, in sand molds and bronze, and then welded together. So there's about 12 sections. And then the face of the TV is cast glass for it, weighs about 60 pounds. And then you'll see the channel setting, because it has that little backlit channel. It's set on the Infinity Channel.
I saw that, yeah.
So
that was what, the Cosmos?
Yeah, the Cosmos. And what's really funny is I see people come and sit here and sit there in the couch and watch TV. And they sit there and stare at it. It never changes channels. And then people have said to me when I've come up there, if they knew I was the artist, you know, if I introduce myself, they'll be like, well, why didn't you make a remote?
Oh.
You know, stuff like that. So, and then on the top of the TV is actually a little map of the artists who were mostly former students of mine who designed the inset sections.
Oh, the mosaic.
Exactly.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
The
oh, good. You figured it out.
Yeah,
good. Yeah. Yeah. Great. Yeah. Because I was hoping that was evident from, you know, the layout of it. So.
Because it was round. Yeah.
Yeah. Good. Oh, good.
This mosaic that the whole living room set sits on.
Yeah.
That tell us about that.
Yeah. Well, that was obviously a major part of this piece, this kind of carpet or this rug.
Mm-hmm.
And I've always done a lot of horizontal, I've always been interested in the ground as a place of beauty. I've always liked looking at the ground and the intricacy of the ground. So that was part of my idea, was that the most beautiful part of the sculpture was actually something you don't see until you come up to it and you walk on it, you know. So it was based on the idea of, I wanted to tie in some motifs of the outlying community in the area, so I asked seven of my students and a local mosaic artist who actually helped me design the whole thing, Margaret Kuhn, to design these inset sections which represented different aspects of life in and around Gresham.
Okay.
So that's where you have all those different inset sections. There's this one over here, which represents Mount Hood, and it shows a snowboarder. And this was done by Jay Muir, and he's a local graffiti artist, snowboarder. And it shows, you know, snowboarder up on the mountain. There's the sun, there's the snow, and you can see some different writing in the mosaic. So you can see there's a lot of different styles of mosaic that these guys used. This one here was shows the berries of the area, like the it was designed by Hiromi Imagawa, who's Japanese.
Hiromi Imagawa.
And then it was pieced by Jim Davis, and what it shows is again Mount Hood, and she really liked the cute berries. She talked about the cute berries, so there's big images of blueberries, strawberries, and all that. And then there's also the Japanese symbol for wind, which is the little pink kind of three stripes of pink that cross over the mountain that show wind. And then this one was designed by Maritza Antonio. She's originally Filipina.
Oh.
And so her family settled here. And hers is water, the Columbia River. And it's a very abstracted, swirly, blue and white image. And it shows kind of the forces of water.
Mm-hmm.
And that was her idea. And then this next one is by Alima Zepeda of Mexico City. And it was to show the kind of the mystery and magic of Mount Hood. And it shows a scene of the mountain, and there's also an image of the sun, and it's a little bit abstracted on nature a little bit, but you can see, like with all these, how differently they are. There's also this one by Margaret Kuhn that shows the forests around Gresham and that has, it's like a view out from the forest. You're in the forest looking out, and you're seeing the fields down below, and you're seeing some of the blackberries in the woods. And she was actually, again, the person who helped me design, who showed me how to do the mosaic, because I'd never done a mosaic before. So it's like, okay, I'm going to do a 13-foot mosaic. How? You know? And so I was really, really lucky to have her as a consultant for this whole project. She's a fantastic mosaic artist. And then this next one was by Kat Hanick, and it was about the microcircuitry, because there's a lot of Intel, wait, I can't remember. One of the chip makers used to be out here. So it was about that industry in Gresham. So this mosaic under the table here is a tribute to the jazz, the Mount Hood Jazz Festival that occurs in Gresham every year, an annual jazz festival. It's by Margaret Kuhn, and it was a tribute to Leroy Vinegar, a bassist who died earlier that year when this mosaic was being designed. So he's featured in the mosaic. And then the final one is by Lyuba Pekashiva, who's originally German, I'm sorry, a Russian, and she designed one, it was to show the family, and hers is the most abstract in some respects. What she was interested in portraying were the forces of a family, what brings it together, what tears it apart, and just some of the different energy, and that's, of all of them, that's the most abstract. Hmm. But maybe the hardest to show, too, in a sense, you know.
Oh, yeah, yes.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. The design that they're all part of is the land. So you have the fringe of the carpet, which is the, you know, actually the concrete slab, and then the fringe was cut into it. And then inside from that, the first thing you see is a line of band of blue, and that represents the Columbia River. And then the next band in, you start to see these kind of diamond-shaped, and what they represent is some of the basket weaving techniques of the Wasco, some of the indigenous tribes of the Columbia River, like in Wishram, the Wasco Wishram tribes, and some of the twined baskets they would make, but they also represent the mountains, okay, these kind of like blues and greens. And then inside of that, you get to this red, this kind of swirly red, and you'll see that there's different patterns in each of the triangles of red, and that starts to represent the ground, just the earth. And then coming up from that are these intertwined kind of plant or vine shapes. And those represent the berries around here, the plantings around here, the way you see the raspberry bushes trained along the wires, which is kind of a fascinating, I'd never seen that before.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, the way they grow up and then they're trained along like
I hadn't
this.
Seen that until they moved to the Northwest.
Yeah, I know. So that was what that was idea. And then as you go in from there, then you get into the center where you're basically just seeing a, you know, the sun or a representation of the heavens, you know.
This has been fun. Thank you very much, Tamsi Ringer.
Well, thanks so much for having me on.
Sculptress, is that what you call yourself?
Sculptress, sure.
Sculptress. Yeah. Okay.
Nothing dramatic other than New York. How is the rationale that excuses ourselves from killing 600,000 Iraqis when we suffered the loss of 4,000 on 9/11?
I was going to work that morning, and my mom woke me up, and actually, she was an alarmist. She said, "My brother's dead," and it was just because he worked on Manhattan, but he wasn't anywhere near the towers that day. I guess other than conspiracy theories and that kind of stuff, I would say just where has the money that's gone into all the relief funds, how has it been distributed? And also, why haven't we taken better care of the workers that, or the workers that were there, cleaning up the debris, that kind of stuff? And also just, certain toxins, things in the air that precipitated from the towers falling. That's really it right now that I can think of.
September 11th, I was at work and I didn't find out what happened until the end of the day. Why it was all done, because, I mean, if you look at it, it looks like it was a fake, most of it. It looks like the government caused it and created it.
2001, I was still in high school in computer class, just finishing up my senior year. What's really going on over there? What's our real issue being over there? I mean, I just think that we're being fed different things, and I don't think we really know what's going on over there, just what the government's telling us, and which usually isn't the entire thing that's happening.
September 11, 2001, I had a death in my family not too far from September 11th, a little few days before. But on that day, I just couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe what was going on. It seemed like a movie or something, a plane crashing into a building and all that. It just was unbelievable. So I was going through one of the toughest times in my life around that time. My questions are, why are we so involved in other people's business, other people's affairs? My questions are, what can be done here for homeless issues? And that's about it.
I was at school. I said, man, I heard it was all set up by the government. So it wasn't really, my question is, who really did it? Why didn't they say, Osama had something to do with it, but they didn't have no proof or nothing?
I was at work in Florida. Florida. Yeah. Why are we in Iraq? That's my major question. I mean, I don't understand why we're there. I don't understand why we're taking the lives of American citizens, as far as I'm concerned, for oil or for a vendetta for someone's father.
Well, like a lot of people, a terrible morning. I was working for a local transportation district at the time. I was the dial a ride manager. I was also part-time with the National Guard. I was a single dad of two, and I'll probably never forget that morning watching the TV. What questions do I have for the government? I wish I could say I could come up with one, but I just really can't think of a question since that time. So.